about to use my my first grade teacher voice. Please make your way to your seats. Thank you very much. Well, good morning. Praise the Lord, everyone. All right. It's a beautiful, warm Sunday morning. Good to see everyone in the house of the Lord this morning. So I was praying about how to steal Pastor's message this morning. I wanted to share a few things about the spiritual gifts this morning. I really believe that we are in a season for the seers and the hearers. I know I've talked about that before, but everybody has gifts, and everybody's gifts are used by the Holy Spirit to help us all as a body see what God's wanting to reveal to us in a special way. And that's one of the things I think that is most precious about this body, is that God paints beautiful pictures in this house, and he uses every single voice in here to do it. Amen. And we all have gifts, and we perfect our gift by sharing and using it, right? We use that gift, and then as we pour out what God gives us, God gives us more, and as we pour it out, God gives us more, and it's this beautiful evolution, right, of our the progress, right, the perfecting. It's our perfection. God's working out our perfection through his spiritual gifts by his Holy Spirit. And that glorifies God. That gives him glory when we trust him, and when we trust to share that we really believe he speaks to us, that we see things, that we hear things. And the Bible is full of scriptures. You know, I think about Isaiah, I saw the Lord high and lifted up. You know, and John on the island of Patmos, right? Yeah, in Revelation, he saw the sea of like glass. You know, the book was open. I mean, all these beautiful scriptures, the Lord said, you know, and the Lord said, and we hear that even here. There's so many of us. I know that some of us are seers, some of us are hearers, some of us just perceive. But all of us, when we use those gifts, it's a beautiful thing, and we need everybody to look and to listen and see what the Lord would share. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, it talks about the spiritual gifts. And I'm going to read out of the Message Bible. What I want to talk about now is the various ways God's spirits get worked out into our lives. This is a complex and often misunderstood, but I want you to be informed and knowledgeable. So I'm just going to say what he said. It's my intent this morning. God's various gifts are handed out everywhere, but they all originate in God's Spirit. God's various ministries are carried out everywhere, but they all originate in God's Spirit. God's various expressions of power are in action everywhere, but God himself is behind it all. Each person is giving something to do that shows who God is. Everyone gets in on it, and everyone benefits. All kinds of things are handed out by the Spirit, and to all kinds of people. The variety is wonderful. Wise counsel, clear understanding, simple trust, healing the sick, miraculous acts, proclamation, distinguishing between spirits, tongues, and the interpretation of tongues. All of these gifts have a common origin, but are handed out one by one by the one Spirit of God, and he decides who gets what and when. I want you to think about how all these make you more significant, not less. A body isn't just a single part blown up into something huge. It's all the different but similar parts arranged and functioning together. That's so important, because when one person isn't here, we miss out on that perspective, on that position, right? I think about the battle. We have battles, but there's a war. There's a war on all fronts and all continents and all places. And if we don't have the view from the mountaintop, and if we don't have the view from the valley, and if we don't have the view from sea and from land, how do we know what's going on and where? Right. It takes everybody to be victorious. Amen. And let's see. The way God designed our bodies is a model for understanding our lives together as a church. Every part dependent on each other, each and every other part, the parts we mention and the parts we don't, the parts we see and the parts we don't. If one part hurts, every other part is involved in that hurt and in the healing. If one part flourishes, every other part enters into the exuberance. You are all Christ's body. That's who you are. You must never forget this. Only as you accept your part of that body does your part mean anything. You're familiar with some of the parts that God has formed in his church, which is the body. Apostles, prophets, teachers, miracle workers, healers, helpers, organizers, those who pray in tongues. But it's obvious by now, isn't it, that Christ's church is a complete body and not a gigantic unidimensional part. It's not all apostles, it's not all prophets, it's not all miracle workers, it's not all healers, not all prayers in tongues, not all interpreters of tongues, and yet some of you keep competing for so-called important parts. But now I want to lay out a far better way for you. And then it goes into chapter 13, which is the way of love. You know, as I think about that, whether you're a toe or a finger, you have different perspective, but the body can't function without either.
Right.
And whether you're a liver or a lung,
yeah,
depending on the lives we lead, right? We don't see those parts, but they're vital.
Right.
There's no breath. There's no purification. There's different parts that all of us play. And every one of us, we need every bit of intel, right? Intelligence, military intelligence. We need military intelligence to the plans of and the attacks, for wisdom and for victory. But we're not seeking to fight the battle, because we know we're not called to fight the battle, but we're seeking how to direct our prayers, and we're seeking direction on where we need wisdom, on where we need God to reveal something. That's what we're seeking. Because more important than the enemy's plans is God's direction, his vision, and his strategy, because he sees the end from the beginning. So we're not seeking to come up with our own plan. We're seeking to know how to ask the right questions, to pray, to listen, and where to look. How many times have we walked by the same thing over and over, and then just that one time you notice something that changes everything? Or I always think of those 3D pictures, right? So you have to stare at them, but then when you're not looking, you see, you know? I always think of that.
Yeah.
It's just like that in the spirit. So many people have asked, well, what do you mean you see? Well, it's different, right? Well, it depends. It's perceiving, and it's trusting that what you see, you don't look at it, but you see it. You know it's there. You perceive it. I don't know if that makes any sense, but if we're not open, if we're not looking, if we're not knocking, if we're not asking, if we're not seeking, then it's so hard to see. We need the light, right? To have vision, you have to have light. You cannot see in darkness. And God will shine his light.
Yes.
To hear, we need quiet. And how many of you know this world is not a quiet place?
Yeah.
Our homes are not a quiet place. My mind is not a quiet place. But we have to know how to quiet and to hear. And I think about the sounds of this world. How many of God's sounds are just beautiful? The ocean, the wind in the trees, the birds singing, music itself. Well, that's my favorite, of course. I know, right? I know. Creation calls. But God's sounds are beautiful, and they create peace in us. They create harmony. And so many times we are so distracted by all the junk that just goes on, all man-made sounds, the horns honking, the phone ringing, the text notifications, just the stuff in life.
Right.
But we have to figure out a way to quiet our spirit man and to hear. Because if we aren't seeking, if we're not looking, we're not going to see. If we're not asking God to shine the light, it won't be illuminated, and the revelation can't come. We can't quiet to hear. And that's our part. That's our warfare, is to listen and to hear. There's a difference between listening and hearing.
Right.
I can listen, but am I hearing, right? We've all had a conversation with someone that you know was listening, but they did not hear you, right? And we've all looked at something, but we didn't really see. God reveals the root of every situation. The things that we're battling, that's not what we're battling. We battle spiritual principalities and powers in high places, and God will cast down those vain imaginations with his word, with his spirit, with the light of his revelation, with the wind of his spirit, with our voices. Our part is to look and to see, to listen and to hear, ask to knock, to seek. Stir up your gifts. That's all I want to say this morning, is stir up your gifts.
Amen.
We are in a time of intense spiritual warfare, and we need every person to connect. And I want to say in Habakkuk, I love how it says in Habakkuk, chapter 2, verse 2, "And the Lord answered me and said, write the vision and engrave it so plainly upon the tablets that everyone who passes by will be able to read it easily and quickly." We need to share. It's not going to do me any good to hear and to see and to listen if I can't share it. It might do me a little bit of good, but it's going to do all of us a lot of good if we share it. And then once we share it, write it down. Write it in the tablets of our heart. Write it somewhere, like the post-it notes. Pastor always talks about putting those post-it notes everywhere. Whatever we need to do to remember, to remind ourselves, to stir that up. And that's when God is glorified, when he reveals himself through every single one of us, and we see him and know him so much more plainly.
Exactly.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Do we have any prayer requests or testimonies this morning?
So if he can get you to focus on that, he gets you out of
praise reports this morning, Sheila?
Jessica's mother does have gallbladder cancer and just prayers for that. Jane Whitehoff and Wendy, I want to give you her phone number. She wants her to call her, but anyway. Evelyn is at University Park Nursing Home. I finally found her. Just pray that she gets strength and she wants to go back to the assisted living at this point. She's not even close to being able to do that, but she still has the faith that she can, so
amen.
In his name.
In his name.
All right. And I would ask for prayer. My dad has a hip replacement surgery on Wednesday. Time yet to be determined. And his bedroom's up about 15 stairs, and so is the shower, so we're yet to work that all out, but in Jesus' name, we'll all be worked out.
Amen.
So, and we'll be pain-free in Jesus' name, in the hip. Yes.
And just remember Sally, when I mentioned it Wednesday night, for those of you that weren't here, just be confessing her healing. She has shingles on top of the stuff the enemy's been throwing at her. So this is just what the devil does.
Yes.
It just happens to be one of those attacks.
Yes.
But she'd appreciate your prayer. I know that. Remember her.
Amen.
Amen.
An attack on one of us in the body is an attack on all of us in the body.
Right.
And I feel so strongly about that. And I know what Cindy's been through,
right,
what Sally's been through. It's not okay. And it's just not necessary. And
right.
I'm
Amen.
Done with it. Personally, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
All right, well, let's stand and go to the Lord this morning. Heavenly Father,
praise
we come before you this
God.
Morning
Thank
in one
Jesus.
Mind and one accord. We
God.
Gather together in your name, in this house, a house of prayer, where your name is lifted high, where you are exalted, Lord. Reveal yourself this morning, Lord. Reveal yourself through every mouth, through every eye, through every ear in this place this morning. That as you reveal yourself, we will exalt you, Lord. We will lift you up. We will glorify your name. We will thank you, Lord. And as we speak the needs for this body, Lord, the healing that needs to come, Lord, the restoration, Lord, we thank you for the praise reports. We thank you that you go before where the needs are and you prepare the way, Lord. That you have healed those by your blood years ago. We turn our eyes to you, Lord. Let us have eyes to see, ears to
yes,
hear.
Lord, yes, Lord, yes, Lord.
Your Spirit leads and guides us, Lord. Illuminate
yes,
our path
Lord.
By your word.
Glory, glory,
Jesus,
glory,
help
glory,
us to
glory,
our minds
glory,
as we focus on you, Lord.
To the hills from
to
whence
hear,
my help comes from.
To see, Lord, to share, to write it
lift
into tablets
voice,
so that all who come by may know you.
Look to the hills.
May know your revelation, your truth.
Where my help comes from.
Your grace and your mercy, Lord.
Healing, healing.
Oh, we thank you, Lord, that your grace is sufficient for every need, Lord.
Healing,
that your grace is sufficient, Lord, and that your mercies are new every day, Lord. And we will rejoice in this day, the day that you have made, Lord. Testimonies of salvation. that is permanent, that is eternal, Lord. Let it bring forth good fruit for your glory, Lord. We know that you use all things for good. And we are called by your name. We are yours. You have sealed us by your Holy Spirit and bought us with your blood. We thank you. Thank you, Father.
Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? Yes, Lord. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
John and Don, do you want to come take the offering this morning, please? Don, do you want to ask the blessing this morning, please?
Heavenly Father, we're so thankful to be here today.
Yes, Lord,
we are overwhelmed by your presence.
Yes.
And by the power that is in your word.
Yes.
And Lord, we know you have anointed us to take charge of the situation
of
the land.
Yes.
When we see all these things come upon the earth, we know that the enemy is like a roaring lion. But you have given us dominion.
Yes. Hallelujah.
And Father, bring us to a point where we will begin to take dominion over the enemy. We see his filthy work everywhere.
Yes.
Lord, let us stand fast and declare that he has not the power that he thinks he has.
That's
because
right.
We can do all things through Christ.
Yes, Lord.
So we just pray that you'll have your way today in the service, that it will be
power. Yes.
Yes.
Bless this offering. Bless all those in attendance today. For we ask it all in the name that's above every name.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus.
Jesus.
Amen.
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 Y'all got your praise on this morning? If not, get it on now. Come on now. Let's worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, for he alone is worthy of all praise and glory and honor. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Worship you, Lord. Declare your goodness, Lord. Every voice in this place, sing hallelujah. Praise our God, seek his face, sing hallelujah. Every tribe, every tongue, sing hallelujah. everything, everyone. Sing hallelujah. For the Lord our God is a righteous King. Sing hallelujah. For the Lord our God is enthroned on high. Sing hallelujah. For he's rescued us with his strong right hand. Sing hallelujah. He has filled our lives with his faithful love. Sing hallelujah. Every voice in this place, sing hallelujah. Praise our God, seek his face, sing hallelujah. Every tribe, every tongue, sing hallelujah. Everything, everyone, sing hallelujah. For the Lord our God is a righteous King. Sing hallelujah. For the Lord our God is enthroned on high. Sing hallelujah. He has rescued us with his strong right hand. Sing hallelujah. He has filled our lives with his faithful love. Sing hallelujah, yeah. You're faithful, love, Lord. You're faithful, love, Lord. Young and old, rich and poor.
Sing hallelujah.
Low and low, exalt the Lord.
Sing hallelujah.
For the Lord our God is a righteous King. Sing hallelujah. For the Lord our God is enthroned on high. Sing hallelujah. He has rescued us with his strong right hand. Sing hallelujah. He has filled our lives with his faithful love. Sing hallelujah. Sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Lift your voice.
Rescued us with his strong right hand. Sing hallelujah. He has filled our lives with his faithful love. Sing hallelujah.
For the Lord.
For the Lord our God is enthroned on high. Sing hallelujah. For the Lord our God is enthroned on high. Sing hallelujah. Rescued us with his strong right hand. Sing hallelujah. He has filled our lives with his faithful love. Sing hallelujah.
Sing hallelujah.
Sing hallelujah. Sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah, Lord.
because of your love, because of your love. Oh, our sins are washed away. We will live forever. Now we have this hope because of you. Oh, the city of our God, because of you. Yeah.
Let's do that first verse again.
There's a place where we stand, where the glory of the Lamb.
Come on, sing.
There's a way we can go there. We can live there beyond time because of you. Because of you, because of your love, because of your love. Oh, our sins are washed away. We will live forever. Now we have this hope because of you. Oh, we'll see you face to face. We'll dance together in the city of our God because of you.
No more pain. Come on, pain.
No more pain. No more sadness. No more suffering. No more tears. No more sin. No more sickness. No injustice. No more death because of you. Because of you, because of your love, because of your blood, oh, our sins are washed away. We will live forever. Now we have this hope because of you. Oh, our sins are washed away. Together in the city of our God because of you.
Hallelujah, Lord! There is joy.
There is joy.
Everlasting. There is gladness. There is peace. There is wine ever flowing. There's a wedding.
There's a feast because of you. Because of you, because of your love, because of your love. Oh, our sins are washed away. We will live forever. Now we have this hope because of you. Oh, we'll see you face to face. In the city of our God, because of you.
Let's do that last verse. There is joy, everlasting.
There is joy, everlasting.
There is gladness. There is peace. There is wine ever flowing. There's a wedding.
There's a feast because of you. Because of you.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
Because of your love. Because of your love. Oh, our sins are washed away. We were there forever. Now we have this hope because of you. Oh, we'll see you face to face. We will dance together in the city of our God because of you.
We'll see you face to face.
Oh, we'll see you face to face. We will dance together in the city of our God because of you.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good and his mercy endures forever. Hallelujah. Woo! Glory to your name, Lord Jesus. You alone are worthy. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. It says in this last song, there is wine ever flowing. He poured his spirit out upon me, and it's going to flow out from each and every one of you. That wine is flowing. And then when we even meet to him, go into his place with him in the heavenly realms, The wine ain't going to stop. So the wine is ever flowing. All I can say to y'all people, let it pour out. Let it pour out. Let the anointing, the things the Lord has put in your life, the Lord has the anointing on your life, let it pour out. Don't think you'll empty yourself out, because he'll fill you up faster and even with more than you have now. So let it go. Let it go. Ask for more. More anointing. More anointing. Thou Christ, a burning, cleansing flame, send a fire. The blood-bought gift today we claim, send the fire today. Look down and see his waiting host. Give us the promised Holy Ghost. We want another Pentecost. Send the fire today. Oh, God of Elijah, hear our cry. Send the fire. And make us fit to live or die. Send the fire today. Burn up every trace of sin, to bring the light and the glory in. The revolution now begins. Send the fire today. Send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire.
Send the fire.
Send the fire, send the fire, send the fire, send the fire today. 'Cause it's fire we want, fire we plead, send the fire. The fire will meet our every need. Send the fire today. Full strength to ever do the right. For grace to conquer in the fight. For power to walk the world in white. Send the fire today. Send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire today. Send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire today. Send the fire. Send the fire.
Send a fire.
Send the fire.
We need your fire, Lord. We need your fire, Lord. We need your fire, Lord.
Send the fire. Send the fire today.
Send a fire.
Send fire. Send the fire. Send the fire. Send the fire today. Send the fire today.
the fire today.
We need your fire, Lord. We need your fire, Lord. We need your fire, Lord. Sing your fire, Lord. Send your fire, Lord. Rekindle. Rekindle my spirit, Lord. Though the enemy has tried to wash out and snuff out the flame, Lord, reignite me, Lord, with your presence, Lord. Reignite me with your presence, Lord. The calling you have placed on our lives, Lord, let them come to shine. Those in you in this room, you are being called. Hear the call of the Lord. He'll send his fire on you today. Send his fire on you today. Healing rain is pouring out on you right now. Healing rain is pouring out. He created you in this, your mother's womb, for this day, for this time, for this hour. It doesn't matter how old you are. It doesn't matter how young you are. He will rain on you. He will cause the things to grow in your life. He created things for you. He created your life to glorify his kingdom. He'll send his fire today. Send his fire today. Send your fire, Lord. No matter where you're at, no matter the things that you've done in your life, his calling supersedes all those things. If you ask him, if you talk to him, he is ready to listen. It's not like in the old days where he turned his face away from you and wouldn't listen to you. He wants to hear your cries. He knows your tears. He knows your tears. He knows your pain. He stretched out his arms for you on that cross. He took it all. He said it was finished, and he meant it when he said it was finished. Give it to him. It's not about us anymore, church. It's all about him. It's not about programs. It's not about agendas or religion or doctrine. It's all about him. Receive his fire, church. Receive his fire, church.
Say there is no God.
Let them be your words, church. Come on. That's all he's asked us to do. That's all he has asked us to do. That's all he has asked us to do.
This is the evidence that we have. When you think of recreation, it
this recreation, what it was intended for was to remember God's creation and to rest in it.
Yes.
As God did. He created it, he rested. So what we've turned recreation into a lot of exhausting things. But what recreation is really supposed to be about is resting.
Yes.
In the finished work of God.
Yes.
That's your healing. That's your deliverance. That's your prosperity. That is true recreation. It's remembering the creation. It's finished. And we can experience it. Think about that as they sing this.
I believe.
Problem that we have with manifestation is that we're not always remembering the creation. You know, the Bible says that God saw the end from the beginning. Now, that doesn't mean, like we think, that he knew the difference between the end and the beginning. It just simply means that in the beginning, he already had seen the end. He already knows. That's the way God operates. So it's true for us when we're talking about healing, we're already healed. We're already prospered. We're already blessed. We're already delivered. But we have to recreate or recreation or remember what God has done. We have to constantly remind ourselves because otherwise we fall into the situation that Jesus' disciples found themselves in, which was simply that... They said, why can't we do these things that God, Jesus had given them power to cast out demons and to heal the sick and so on and so forth. Now, the Holy Ghost hadn't been poured out, but the Spirit of God was upon them to do this. Jesus empowered them to do that, and they had some success. But when they ran into a situation that was a little bit different or strange or whatever, they were not able to cast out the demon out of that young boy or the spirit of infirmity, whatever it might have been. But they asked Jesus after the fact, why couldn't we do this? And he said, because of your unbelief. Not because of your lack of faith, because they had the faith. They had the faith to do whatever needed to be done, but they were mixing unbelief with faith. This is what the enemy does. Faith looks at things that are not as though they are. Believing has to do with tangible evidence. So sometimes, because you're feeling symptoms or you're seeing your bank account or you're dealing with other issues, you can get into unbelief even though you have faith in God to work the work. So what God is trying to get us to understand is this idea of recreation or recreation. The creation is done. It's finished. We have the kingdom. What we have to do is remember the creation. Recreation, recreation. Remember what God has done. We have to stay focused. Amen. Like I said last week, we listen to ourselves instead of talking to ourselves.
Yes.
we hear every thought that goes through our head and every doubt and every fear and everything else, so we're listening all the time, but when we ought to be talking. My dad used to say, you're talking when you ought to be listening. Well, praise the Lord, Dad, thanks, you were right, but there are times when we need to stop listening and start talking. We need to stop listening to the things that are coming to us in the flesh and start speaking from the Spirit and speak to those things, amen, as though we do have control, that we do have dominance, that we do have power over this area of our life. So we need to be recreating, hallelujah. We need to be having more recreation, amen, or remembering the finished work of God in creation and rest in that.
Amen.
Amen. We don't have to struggle with it. We need to rest in it. That's the problem. You know, you need recreation. Why? Because you burn yourself out working, right? Or doing the stuff that you do all year. So you need some recreation. You need some time away from that stuff. Right?
Yes.
That's what God has given us. He's given us a life of recreation, a life of resting in His finished work. And we're all wanting a vacation. When we don't really need a vacation, we just need a recreation. Hallelujah. We need to remember, amen, what God has provided for us so that we can rest in it. Praise the Lord. All right. Hallelujah. Let's go. Acts chapter 4 and verse 12 is where we'll begin. One verse here and then we'll go to John. But Acts chapter 4 and verse 12. Praise the Lord. And as they, praise God. 12. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. That word salvation is sozo. We've talked about it a lot of times. It's more than just not going to hell. It's about everything that God has provided for us through that act of grace, which is healing, deliverance, prosperity. Everything is wrapped up in that one word there. Amen. All right, so John chapter 14 and verse 6. Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Praise the Lord. So as I just said, being born again is more than just getting into heaven. When we die, we want to know that life is not over. It's just the flesh goes, but we live on. Amen? Who we really are, our true identity is eternal. It's going to live forever. So this is more than just going to heaven. Amen. Jesus died to give us eternal life. That's God life. Amen. He gave us eternal life. And eternal life is oneness with God. It's relationship with God. Now think about this. If we were to focus, really focus on this, you'd understand that God doesn't get sick. God is never financially strapped. God doesn't have any peace issues. You know, we as we talk about the world, the noise, the garbage that the enemy has thrown in, God is not wringing his hands over this mess. It's only natural for us because we're here. We're in the flesh. We're seeing it happen. We're seeing it unfold before our very eyes. But God saw it before the foundation of the world, and he's not nervous. He's not uptight about it. He's relaxed. He's at peace. Because he's seen the finished creation, the finished work, amen, that is successful, amen, in defeating and has defeated the enemy. So this is a relationship that begins the minute you get born again.
Exactly.
As Tammy was saying, most of us have to unlearn so much junk that we've got a mixture of what we believe and what we think should be happening and what we shouldn't. Mixture is not a good thing anywhere, certainly not in the kingdom of God. Because you can't put new wine into old wineskins. You can't change the person, amen, with bad truth, bad teaching, untruths, or half-truths, amen. So look at this in John chapter 17 and verse 3. And this is eternal life, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent, amen. So we've got a relationship with God simply by receiving our forgiveness, amen, as a free gift.
Yes.
Right? That's how you get one with God. That's how you get reconciled to God, is by receiving, that's all you're doing, is receiving a free gift from God.
And I'm telling you, every single thing in the kingdom operates this way because it's all about salvation. Amen? You don't get the gift of salvation or the gift of eternal life and not get the gift of healing. You don't get the gift of salvation or eternal life or relationship with God, reconciliation with God, and not get prosperity. Every single thing, every single promise in this Bible comes as a result of God's grace.
Yes.
Amen. Yes. Salvation and everything else operates the same way. Now, how do you know that you're saved? Because he said so.
Right.
You simply believed what he said. Am I right?
Yep.
Are there questions at times that come that maybe I'm not saved? I mean, does somebody else inject things into your life that says, well, if you were really, and on and on and on and on. And if they don't, your own conscience will tell you that from time to time because the enemy's constantly there telling you, well, you weren't very good today, or that was really a stupid thing to say or thing to do, or what kind of attitude is that to have? You're supposed to be saved, right?
Yes.
It's no different with healing. You've got a body that gives you symptoms, that tells you stuff, amen, that is contrary to what the Word of God says. You have financial situations that are not in agreement with what God has said and provided for you by salvation, by grace. So the battle is always about believing. It's really not about faith. We've made it about get your faith, you know, get faith, get more faith. Listen, God gave us faith. It's a gift. We have faith. He gave us a measure of faith. That's more than enough. He said a grain of a mustard seed. The problem is always unbelief. And the reason that problem exists is because believing is something that affects the natural man. Faith is something that is supernatural. It's spiritual. God gave us faith by grace. We have to battle against unbelief. And the way we do it is through the Word of God. We recreate, we recreate, amen, we rest in that created work of God, the finished work of God. It's a discipline.
It is.
That's why we're called disciples.
Yes.
You have to renew your mind, amen, to this, and you have to do it on a continuing basis. Because life will overwhelm you. Life sucks in many ways. There's a lot of good things about life. Don't you all love life when you're on vacation? Huh? But it's really depressing when you come back. It's bummed because why? You're back into what we call reality. When you're on vacation, everywhere you go, you think, man, I want to move here. I'd love to live here. You know? Why? Because I'm not dealing with life. I'm on vacation. I'm not dealing with reality as we normally think of it when we're not on vacation.
Right.
That's what's so appealing about vacation. Amen? But God has given us recreated life. Recreation. Our life is to be a vacation.
Yes,
we are supposed to be living in rest in the finished work of God.
Amen.
Every day ought to be a holiday. And every meal a feast, praise the Lord. I mean, that's the way we ought to be living our lives if we can get our minds renewed to the faith and the truth of what God has said about it instead of dealing with unbelief all the time.
Absolutely.
Praise the Lord. The devil believes and trembles, but he's not saved. His job is to get us into unbelief. And believe me, he knows something about unbelief.
Right?
You know, in other words, we've all heard this expression before, but if you want to understand or be able to detect bogus currency or you know, phony money, you don't need to inspect every bad piece of paper out there. I mean, you don't have to look at every phony, every, unreal money. You just need to know what the real thing looks like. You get familiar with the real deal, and then you don't get messed up when you get the bad stuff, right? That's the same way it is with the enemy. The enemy knows the truth. So he bombards you not with the truth, but with every bit of lie that he can come up with. to get you distracted from the real thing, when what you should be doing is just looking at the real deal right here and not looking at all or listening to all the lies, all the phony money, all the fake currency. Praise the Lord. Amen. All right, let me show you. Let's look at this. Acts chapter 20, verse 24. This would be the closest thing I'd call working out your own salvation. It's not in any way meaning that we do anything to get saved. But our salvation is more than just going to heaven. Yeah. Our salvation is all that God has provided. And we have to do something about that. God provides it, but just like with initial salvation or being born again, you have to receive it, and you do that by faith. And unbelief cannot enter in. That's why there's something special about church services, I think, where most of us, quote, get saved, not necessarily, but most of us, because it's an environment where there's very little unbelief. People are believing, or they wouldn't be here, right? They have faith. So a lot of times things will happen in a church service or with other believers that won't necessarily happen when you're just by yourself or when you're being bombarded by the enemy. Why? Because there's not unbelief there. There's not the same kind of unbelief as there is in other situations or circumstances. So none of these things move me, Paul says. Neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy and the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God. That is the news. That's the good news. The gospel of the grace of God. There isn't one gospel for you to go to heaven and another gospel for you to get healed.
Right.
There's only one gospel, and it's the gospel of the grace of God. It's the good news, the truth about God's love for you, God's grace for you, and all that He's provided for you by grace. That's what Paul's saying. Everything. I'm telling you, we go a long ways, not only towards our own deliverance and healing and prosperity, by understanding what Paul's talking about here, and by that be able to pray for the sick and actually see them recover. Because if somebody's not being healed, it's not because of a lack of faith on their part or on the person who's doing the praying. It's a question of unbelief. Too much information can mess you up. I mean, when it comes to the, you know, medicine and things like that, it's true of anything. Think about it. If you get you get a degree in finance, man, you're going to be aware of all the places where you can lose your finances. Why? I mean, you're going to be, a lot of focus is on what I don't want to do.
Right.
Right?
Right?
Instead of just what I can do. Amen?
Yeah.
So it's true with healing. Well, yes, by His stripes I'm healed. You were healed. We're not striving to get God to heal us. You were healed. The problem is, everything in your body is saying, how can I be healed when I feel like this?
Yeah.
You know, how can I be prospered when I can't come up with enough money at the end of the month to pay all of the bills that are due?
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So there's always reasons to not believe.
Right.
But none for not having faith. So faith is not the issue. We need to get past that. You got faith to move mountains. Everybody here that's a believer, you can cast out demons.
Right.
You can raise the dead. The problem is there's too much information, too much lies, too much false teaching, too much untruth, amen, that we combat against every time we lay hands on the sick. We say, I believe, I mean, I've got faith. But you're looking at the person who's withering away because of cancer or whatever it is, and you're like those disciples who saw this boy flailing around and, you know, epileptic seizure-like thing, and it freaked them out. They hadn't seen anything like that before.
Right.
And unbelief got a hold of them. Their faith hadn't moved at all. Jesus said, if you have faith as a grain of a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain. The problem is not your lack of faith. He said it's an unbelieving generation. Praise the Lord. And I believe that God has given us all the faith we need. All of this is a done deal. The thing that we battle against in every generation is unbelief.
Yes.
And I believe that the message of this gospel, the true message of this gospel, will be a huge step towards us overcoming unbelief. When you realize it has nothing to do with you. It's grace. It's the gift of God. God wants us to operate totally in thanksgiving, totally in a recreation type of way, remembering the finished work, remembering that He has done it all, remembering that it's all finished, and all we do is just receive it. Thank you, Jesus, for my healing.
Yes.
Doesn't matter what it looks like. Thank you for saving me from sin, even though I still sin. Do you understand what I'm saying? The connection here I'm trying to make is that even though we still operate in the natural world and we still operate naturally, amen, sinning, we do things that are quote-unquote sinful, but we are not sinners anymore because God has declared us the righteousness of God in Christ. So even though my body is telling me one thing, because I'm in the world, amen, where my flesh still is functioning. And so I can feel the symptoms. I can experience the pain, the discomfort. Even though my finances just don't make sense, I can believe, amen, because God has finished it. Even though it doesn't look like it. Even though I'm still sinning, I'm not a sinner. Even though I got symptoms, I have been healed. Amen. Even though I don't have X amount of dollars in the bank, I am prospered. Amen. And the way that manifests is simply by me continuing to confess what God has said. Praise the Lord. That's called recreation. That's called resting. That's called vacay. We got to stay vacay, right? We got to stay here on this earth, but we're still in vacation. Hallelujah. Amen. We still have rest. We still have restoration.
Yes.
Praise God. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, that got me worked up. Galatians chapter 1, verse 6. Praise the name of the Lord. I marvel that you are so soon removed from Him that called you into the grace of Christ into another gospel. Which really, if we were to read on, he'd say, but really isn't another gospel because there's only really one gospel. There can only be one real truth, one continuous, constant truth. But I marvel that you're so soon removed from Him that called you into the grace of Christ into another gospel. We could say that about almost every situation and circumstance in our life because this is the work of the enemy. He don't care about killing you personally or, you know, making life miserable. He wants to get you away from the grace of God and put it back on your shoulders. What did He say? I will ascend. This is His whole MO. This is His modus operandi. This is what He does. He's all about doing, 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 and He wants us to be operating the same way. For us, the Bible tells us who is going to say, I will ascend up and bring Jesus down here, or I will go down and bring Jesus back up, as if He hasn't done everything that needs to be done. Amen?
Amen.
He marveled, Paul says, that you have been so soon removed from Him that called you into the grace of Christ and into another gospel.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Amen? Into unbelief. Praise the Lord. The book of Romans is really just an entire description of what God has done for us, independent of what we deserve. I know a lot of times there used to be, and I think sometimes we still do this, but the Roman road, you know, about salvation, how to be saved, and so on and so forth. But really, Romans is a description. It's Paul describing the reality of grace, what grace really is all about. Amen? It's a description of grace. And Paul says in Romans, look at this again in Romans 1, verses 16 and 17. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It's the power of God unto salvation. The gospel of Christ, which is grace, that is the power of God unto salvation. Not just to go to heaven, but everything that's included in salvation. Grace is the power behind it. Amen? To everybody that believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For therein, in this grace gospel, in this grace truth, therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. So the righteousness of God is revealed by grace. And it's revealed in us. Even though we're imperfect, we're still the righteousness of God in Christ. Amen? Amen. The grace is the power that reveals the righteousness of God. Grace, when you're healed, it shows God's righteousness, God's favor, God's goodness, God's mercy, God's love, God's righteousness. Why? Because God is righteous in that He has dealt with your sin. Or He could not heal you. He could not save you. It would be unrighteous of God to do anything if He didn't first deal with the sin. Once He's dealt with the sin, everything else is part of the package. It all comes, and it all comes the very same way, by grace. Right? That woman that came to Jesus, he said, should not this daughter of Abraham, doesn't she have a right to be healed? You see what I'm saying? That's the way God thinks. This is under the old covenant. But she was a believer, amen. She was a descendant of Abraham, and therefore she had a right based on the promise that God made to Abraham, amen. So Jesus says she's got a right to be healed because she's a believer. Well, how much more should we feel and understand that that's what Jesus is trying to tell us? You have a right. You say, how can I have a right? Because of grace, you have a right to expect healing. You have a right to expect prosperity. You have a right to be delivered. Amen? You're not begging. You're declaring what God has already done. It's already done. You're not trying to get God to do it. You're just trying to get your own little pea brain wrapped around the fact that it is done. Yes. And I don't mean to be disrespectful. Praise the Lord, because I've got one too. Hallelujah. But the truth is, you know, God gives us free will. So we have a right to be ignorant of all of this if we choose. Yeah. But that's not the will of God. The will of God is that you be healed, that you be delivered, that you be prospered. How do I know it? Because by grace He's already done it. Yes. I know the will of God because I know what God has done, not what God's going to do. I don't know God based on what He might do next month. Right. I know God based on what He already did 2,000 years ago. That's how I know Him. That's how I can depend on Him. That's how I can expect healing. That's how I can expect to prosper. Exactly. Praise the Lord. Amen. The religious system that Paul was preaching against was all bad news. It was not good news. It was bad news. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. It was a negative. It was a harsh system. Amen. And people were stoned to death for breaking the law. That's what Paul's fighting against here. The gospel was completely opposed to the religious system that used fear in order to drive people to follow God. Now I want you to just think about the average church service that most of us went to most of our lives. It was totally contrary, again this goes to what Tammy was saying, it was totally contrary to what Paul was preaching. In fact, most of the time, it was exactly what Paul was preaching against. Fear. Anxiety. Maybe God will. Maybe God won't. I don't know. It's because I haven't been that great. And so how in the world? It's nothing but the goodness and the grace of God that anybody ever got healed. Amen. Honestly, if you think about the way most of us were taught, I mean, it was crazy. The gospel was drawing people, the true gospel was drawing people to salvation by the love of God. It's the love of God that calleth men to repentance. This is how we know that we love, because God first loved us.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
Amen. It's a whole different dynamic here.
It is.
And we have to remind ourselves and renew our minds and take a vacation, amen, from the world. A recreation, a recreation, amen, that reminds us it's finished. Rest, relax, declare what God has said in the face of your symptoms, in the face of your financial situation. Amen. Just the same way you do when the enemy comes and says, oh, I know you wish you were saved, but that didn't look saved to me. Well, you're a liar. What do I care what you think? God has said, what I have cleansed, nobody can make unclean. Amen?
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. Amen. The gospel of grace, it doesn't just save us from sin. The gospel of grace saves us from the consequences of sin. You need to hear that. Because we know there are consequences to bad behavior. We know. We tell our kids that. You know, I'm not angry at you because you made a mistake. I just want you to know there are consequences for that kind of behavior. Play in the street, consequences are you're likely to get hit by a car. It's not that I don't love you. It's not that I don't want you to have fun. I just don't want you getting run over. Right? But listen to this. What the gospel of grace does is not only save us from sin, it saves us from the consequences of sin. How many of you here have done some really stupid, don't raise your hand, have really done something stupid, you know it was sinful, you did it without any consequences? I mean, you escaped. You got away with it. You, right? This is the good news. Now, that doesn't mean you could go out here and just be an idiot and think that nothing's ever going to happen. But what I'm saying is God's grace even goes beyond payment for that sin.
Thank you, Lord.
He's dealt with the consequences of that sin.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Right? I mean, smoke 2-3 packs of cigarettes a day for 50 years. You get cancer, you say what? Well, I got it coming. Right? I mean, logically, of course, you knew at some point, if you're my age, it was a while before you found out that they were bad for you. I mean, it was like, who knew? These must be good for you after all. I don't see any Surgeon General sign on it or anything else. Yeah, I mean, I lived before they had that, praise the Lord. And I, this makes you an adult now, and, you know, praise the Lord. You smell like a bonfire? Cool. Right? Now, I'm not calling smoking cigarettes sin. Don't misunderstand me. I'm just saying about a consequence for behavior. So, but how many people do we know that smoked, never got cancer, never died of a heart attack? Right? They escaped the consequences of that habit. I, for one, I smoked for years. From the time I was about 16 till I was in my late 30s, mid-30s anyway. 15, 20 years, whatever it was. Excuse me. I'm just saying, we've all done things that we have escaped the consequences of, and it's because of God. Think of it this way. Oppression, depression, sickness, disease, poverty, those are the true residuals of sin. Now, it doesn't mean that you're sinning if you get depressed. But those are the results of a fallen humanity. And God has told us we've been delivered from it. But just because God said we've been delivered from it doesn't mean we experience that deliverance. We have to renew our minds. So when those things come against us, we have to do as Suzanne was saying here, we have to pull down every imagination, every stronghold that tries to establish itself contrary to the Word of God. Amen. Finances. I mean, we've got to remember what God has said. We have to recreation. We have to remember the creation and the finished work of God in order to really participate in the kingdom in the way God intended us to. I mean, it's like coming to the United States and being a naturalized citizen and hiding out somewhere for fear that you're going to be exposed because you're not an American. You know, like you don't know you have citizenship. So you're paranoid all the time that you're going to get busted, that you're going to get picked up and you don't have your green card or you don't have the whatever card you got to have. When all the time you have a right to everything within this country that is offered to the citizenry. This is what's happened to us in the kingdom of God. We are kingdom people.
Yes, we are.
And we're living like we don't deserve the kingdom.
True.
We're not experiencing what the kingdom has to offer because we think we're aliens. And the truth is we're aliens in this world, not in that one.
On.
We came from that world.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So when Paul says that the gospel is the power of God unto salvation, you need to understand that the gospel or grace is the power of God for healing, for peace, for joy, for prosperity. It's not based on anything other than God's grace.
Thank you, Lord.
Paul says, this is the power of salvation. Grace is the power. It's the thing that makes it work. If it's what makes you're not going to hell work, then I'm guessing it'll make your not getting sick in your body work as well.
Amen.
Same way with your finances. Praise the Lord. This isn't an indictment on people that get sick. I get sick. I have depression. I go through the same stuff everybody else goes through. But look, at some point we got to grow up and say what it is and just start dealing with it that way. This isn't an indictment against people that go through financial crisis any more than it is an indictment against somebody who's struggling with a habit, amen, or a sickness or anything else. All of that stuff is bogus. It isn't the important issue.
Right.
What's important is that God has declared them righteous, holy, perfect, and deserving of healing and deliverance and prosperity because they are heirs and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. You got to talk to yourself about that. You got to preach it to you. You have to remind yourself. That's why we hear that expression all the time. I am the righteousness of God in Christ. What are we doing? Are we acting like we're just stupid to everything else? Well, in some sense, we need to be. We need to, what that literally means is that because of God's grace, I have a right. Now that sounds presumptuous and kind of egotistical when it comes to God, but the truth is that's how God wants you to act. I do not want my children or grandchildren coming to my house and running around like a scared dog with a tail between their legs, fear, I don't. Can I have a bite of that cookie, or can I have a sandwich, or would you give me a glass of juice, or man, I want them to come in and say, hey, give me some juice, give me a glass of juice, give me a cookie, give me the, I want them to feel like, hey, it's your house, it's my house, it's your house, you've got a right to come in here and enjoy everything that I've got. I love you, you're my kids, my grandkids. I don't want you feeling timid. The Bible says, come boldly, amen, to the throne of grace, believing that whatever you ask for, you're going to receive. Because God is a loving God, a loving Father. He wants you blessed. He wants you prospered. He wants you whole. Hallelujah. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 8 and 9. We get mad at ourselves. We get mad at the bank. We get mad at the doctor. We get mad at the preacher. We get mad at one another. We just get mad at the devil.
Yes.
Just get mad at him. Take it out on him. You can do some stuff to him, and he knows it, and he is afraid of you.
Yes, he
believes in God. in that one God. And he trembles. Why? Because he knows, amen, that if we know what he knows, he is in serious trouble. You can cast him out. You can run him off. You can do whatever you need to do. You just need to know what he knows. Because you have access to it and he doesn't. He just has knowledge. No revelation. No real experiential realities in it. Amen? We know that the law is good if a man uses it lawfully. I'm not against the law if you use it for the right reason. Knowing this, that the law is not made for a righteous man. What did we just discover here? We are the righteousness of God in Christ. Therefore, that law is not for us. Amen? But it's for the lawless, the unsaved, the unbeliever, the disobedient, the ungodly, the sinners, for unholy and profane, for murderers, fathers, murders of mothers, for manslayers. Yep. Praise the Lord. That isn't us.
Correct.
Praise God. Okay. The simple result of this is whoever believes in Jesus has been made righteous.
Yes.
The righteousness of God.
Yes.
Because true righteousness only comes from one place. You can be self-righteous, but that's not real righteous. Real righteousness only comes from God. That's why he says we are the righteousness of God in Christ.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21. So you're a believer. You are righteous. Right? For he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. So the law isn't meant to be used against you.
Right.
So when the Ten Commandments come up, or any other legalistic thing, it's not for you. Just don't listen.
That's right.
It's not for you. Sounds like a vacation to me. I mean, from religion. Now, come on, that's what the Bible says. It is, I'm not trying to just make it up. I'm saying what it says.
Right.
You are righteous. Because you're righteous, you have a right to everything that righteousness provides. That's your healing. That's its gospel. It's the grace of God. It's your healing. It's your deliverance. It's your prosperity.
Yes.
Do not let a lying devil cheat you or some misinformed or ill-informed preacher or Christian lead you down some path that's taking you away from God and putting you back to work where you're supposed to be recreation. You're supposed to be having recreation and you're work, and trying to get something that God already gave you that you should just be resting and enjoying.
Amen.
Somebody say praise the Lord. Hallelujah. The law is not meant for unbelievers. True Christianity, think about it. Real Christianity, as we understand it, is the only faith that is based on God's goodness and not man's. That's what makes it unique, and that's why it's not a religion. It's a relationship. I defy you. Go look through any, I don't care, any religion outside of real, true Christianity, and it's about man trying to appease God or trying to reach God through his good works or through his labor or through his sacrifices or whatever.
Right.
That is not a vacation.
Right.
That is a life filled with disappointment,
yes,
defeat,
yes,
discouragement, and condemnation.
Right.
Everything that we have been delivered from by the gospel of his grace. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. For by grace are ye saved through faith, that not of yourselves. It's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. By grace are you saved, or made whole and complete, through faith, which also happened to come by grace, and that not of yourselves, it's the gift of God. not of works, so that nobody can boast about it. God has provided everything. Everybody say everything.
Everything.
God has provided everything by grace. John 1:17. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. Grace came to earth 2,000 years ago. In the person of Jesus.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24. Who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we being dead to sin should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes you were healed. We live unto righteousness. Now, you know, religiously we say, okay, then that means, see, we're dead to sin, so we need to be righteous, do righteous, right? Do right, do good, do the law. There are actually people who believe that when you get born again, you have now been made able to keep the law. It's not true. Man was never meant to keep the law. The law was meant to expose man's inability to keep the law, even saved people.
Yes.
Because if you could keep the law, you wouldn't need grace for when you break the law.
Right.
If you could keep the law, there would have been no reason for Jesus to do away with the law,
right,
as far as the believer is concerned.
Exactly.
The law just isn't a reality for us anymore. It doesn't exist for us. The law has been fulfilled. Read Deuteronomy sometime about all the curses that come if you don't comply and keep all the law. And then look at the blessings that come if you do keep the law. Well, nobody kept the law until Jesus.
Right.
Jesus kept the law, and because we're in Christ, we have a right to every one of those blessings, every one of those promises,
yes,
from God. Not because of anything we did, because what we've done deserves the other side of that. But God's not basing his judgment of us on the law.
Amen.
He's basing it on grace.
Yes.
Jesus kept the law. That's applied to us. We have a right to every promise.
Yes.
Blessed in the city, blessed in the,
yes,
field. Blessed going in, blessed coming out. Head and not the tail. Lender and not the borrower.
Exactly.
I mean, read it sometime. That is your promise from God, based on his finished work.
Amen. Amen.
Anything less than that, we're not getting everything God wants us to have.
Sure.
It's hung up someplace, and we're not receiving it. Not because God hasn't released it, because we know it came 2,000 years ago.
Right.
Praise the Lord. And it didn't go anywhere.
Right.
What grace set into motion still exists. It goes on. Hallelujah. Praise God. When did Jesus, by the way, when did Jesus receive those stripes? 2,000 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
It's finished.
Right.
Your healing was taken care of 2,000 years ago.
Yes. Yes.
Because of grace, you have a right to be healed.
Amen.
It's your heritage.
Yes.
It's not just a, you know, gee, wouldn't that be great? No, this is your inheritance. This is your heritage.
It is.
Just like you could say, well, I'm an American. What did you do to be an American?
Yeah.
Well, my mom and dad. Well, but I wasn't. You just got born.
That's exactly right.
What did you do to receive this heritage or this inheritance from God? You didn't do anything. You got born again.
Amen.
You got born from above. God gave you new life, a new birth. Amen. And with that new birth comes a heritage.
Yes.
An inheritance.
Yes. Yes.
Praise God. Amen. Your healing has already been accomplished.
Thank you,
Your prosperity has already been provided for. Hallelujah. Ephesians 1 and 3. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath, past tense, blessed us with all spiritual blessings, that would be every single thing that the Spirit provides, in heavenly places, in the Spirit, in Christ Jesus. It comes to us by the Spirit. It comes to our spirit. Then our spirit, if it's dominant, if it's aware and in control, it speaks to, as Don was saying, we've been given authority over everything on this planet, including this flesh. How do you dominate it? By beating it with whips and chains and not eating for weeks? And no, you dominate it by speaking the truth. Confessing what God has said. Hallelujah. It's all done, and it's all by grace.
Yes.
Everything. Listen, God is so good. We say, oh, God, He's good, God is good. But we don't really act like it. We act like He's, well, He's good, but He's really strict. You got the daddy of all daddies.
Yes.
He is a spoiler.
Yes, he
is. He'll spoil your rotten if you just let Him. You ever had a dog that you couldn't do stuff for? I mean, it's like he thought you were mean. I don't know where it comes from, if they were trained, that raised in a different environment or something. But somehow, there are some dogs, you go and you try to pet them, and they're peeing down their leg and on you too, and all shaken and nervous, and you try to give them a treat, and they cower and run away. And that's the way we are with God a lot of times. God is reaching down to just give us a touch, a blessing. We're ducking and dodging and thinking, oh, here he comes, he's after me now. It's because we got a wrong perception, a wrong understanding of how good God is. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. It's all done. It's all by grace. Ephesians 1, 19 and 20. And what is the exceeding greatness of His power to usward who believe? What is this great power that He's given us according to the working of His mighty power that He wrought in Christ when He raised Him from the dead and set Him at His own right hand in heavenly places? Hallelujah. You've already got it.
Yes.
It's all by grace. Prosperity, anointing, wisdom, faith, and on and on and on and on. It's grace, 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 that is this power. It's the power of the gospel. It's the very thing that raised Jesus from the dead. It's the dunamis that we talk about. It is the power of God unto salvation.
Yes.
It's grace. How in the world can we not accept that? Be bold about it. Who cares what anybody else thinks? They've got a right to be ignorant, but you know more. Hallelujah. God is just, it's like He just wants so desperately to see every one of us healed. Every one of us prospered, because He paid such a cost for it. He paid for this. He did not just die for you to not go to hell. He was beaten so you could be healed. He was poor so that you could be rich. He paid for this. He wants you to enjoy it. Imagine you work your whole life, you save a few bucks, you want to give it to your child before you die or when you die, and you're laying there on the deathbed, the kid comes in and you says, son, daughter, look, made a few bucks, I want your life to be better than my life. I want you to experience everything that maybe I didn't get to experience. I want you to enjoy it. I want you to be able to relax and enjoy life and not feel like you've got to struggle every minute and fight for it. And the kid looks at you and goes, no thanks. I don't think I want it. I'm not sure that the check's good. I'm afraid to cash it, it might bounce. That's the way our minds work. That's the way our heads play these games with us when God has provided it all. Hallelujah. John 6:63. Really fast here. We'll be done by noon. Hallelujah. It's the Spirit that quickeneth. The flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. And here's the reality. Most Christians aren't walking in the Spirit or by the Word of God. Not at you, of course, but I mean most Christians. Y'all got it together. Praise the Lord. But the average Christian is trying to navigate through life by their feelings. If I feel good, God's with me. God's blessing me. If I feel lousy, God's, you know, I don't know where he is. I don't know what he's up to. We're supposed to be living by grace and by the Word of God. Living in a position of receiving, thankfully, gratefully, and that is the only way you can walk in the Spirit. You can't really be in the Spirit except by grace. Because it's your effort to try to get in the Spirit. When in fact, if you just would relax, you'd find pretty quick you are in the Spirit. You are a spirit. Think about it. When God deals with you, he doesn't deal with your flesh. He deals with your spirit. It always comes from the inside out. We may not always understand that. We may see a manifestation and think, oh, God just showed up. No, God showed up 2,000 years ago. It just now manifested because you're operating by the Spirit. You're thinking the way God thinks. You're operating from that finished place of grace. Hallelujah. Philemon 6. And notice that, I want you to notice this here. In Philemon chapter 6, or verse 6, he says, the communication of your faith, which is what we're talking about here when we do testimonies and when we're dealing with other people, other Christians or non-Christians, this is what we do. The communication of thy faith may become effectual by the acknowledging of every good thing which is in you in Christ Jesus. Look at this. This is powerful. So that the communication of your faith, the way you can express your faith, may become effectual. That word effectual means begin to happen. Amen. How does it begin to happen? How does this communication of my faith, or manifestation, you might say, of my faith really take place? It happens, it begins when I acknowledge, every good thing which is in me in Christ Jesus. What every good thing is in me? Prosperity, healing,
yes.
Deliverance.
Yes.
See, I can't be effectively communicating the faith of Christianity without acknowledging that it's in me. I can't effectively communicate healing unless I realize I'm already healed. They are already healed if they're a believer. Think about this. See, the miracle of healing really is only for the unbeliever. Because you were already healed 2,000 years ago. It's the unbeliever who needs somebody who has faith and understanding to communicate that faith by the laying on of hands. God doesn't, it's okay for us to pray, you know what I'm saying, pray, lay hands on one another and pray for it. But really, that is the lesser thing. What God wants us to do is just walk in divine health because we have acknowledged, amen, every good thing that is in us in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
That makes us an effective communicator of the gospel.
Yes.
When we know what we've got and we're willing to share it.
Yes.
Right? Praise the Lord. Effectual. It means to begin to work.
Yep.
Praise the Lord. Paul says, faith works by acknowledging every good thing that's in you by grace in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
1 Corinthians 2, verse 14. The natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him, neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned.
Amen.
See, you can't know this without grace.
Exactly right.
The natural man doesn't receive the things of the Spirit of God. That tends to cause me to believe that I'm operating too much from my natural man rather than from who I really am in Christ.
Exactly.
I've let my natural man dominate my thinking, and my symptoms tell me what I am or who I am. I let my bank account determine if I'm blessed or not. You know what I'm saying? Instead of operating from who I am in Christ, I'm operating as a natural human because that's what we're dealing with all the time. Because that stuff is foolishness. Amen. Neither can he know them because they are spiritually discerned. You cannot discern without the grace of God. You just can't. Amen. Galatians chapter 5, verses 2 through 4. As you find out, as you get into this more and more, you'll realize, hey, you're hearing from God all the time. God is constantly talking to you and impressing you with things and moving on you in certain ways. Amen? Because of grace. The problem is, we think we're only hearing from him if we really do some serious stretching and, you know, thinking. No. By grace, he has made you to understand the things of God. Spiritual truths. That's why you get people standing, just in our testimonies and stuff, people say things and you go, my God, where did they get that? You know, you read the same scriptures over and over and over and you hear it and you go, whoa. Why? Because by grace, God just releases the mind of Christ.
Yes.
Wisdom. Amen. Behold, I, Paul, say to you that if you be circumcised, Christ shall profit you nothing. For I testify again to every man that is circumcised that he is a debtor to the whole law. That's, you know, obviously circumcision was a part of the law. So he's saying circumcision ain't getting you anywhere.
That's right.
Your religious stuff, rituals, they don't amount to anything. Christ is become, because if you do that, Christ has become of no effect unto you. Whosoever of you are justified by the law, you're fallen from grace.
Right.
Means grace isn't effective. It isn't effectual in your life. It isn't doing you any good. Praise the Lord. Now, it doesn't mean you're not going to heaven. It just means the total package that God provided through salvation by grace, you're going empty-handed. You're getting the one thing you got to die for to get, and the rest of the stuff you're not enjoying at all. You're not getting any vacation. You're not getting any recreation. This is all you got to die to get the benefit. Meantime, you got to work till Jesus comes. Amen. So there's no vacation for you. There's no recreation for you. You just got to keep at it. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. God isn't dealing with us through the law anymore, in any fashion. He's just not. We've been saved by grace and delivered by grace, healed by grace, prospered by grace, and every other area in our life is touched and manifest by grace as a result of grace. We are by grace able to understand spiritual things. If you just expect to hear from God and to receive from God and to understand because of God's grace, it happens. It just happens. You can have read the Bible hundreds of times and thinking that I'm trying to get in the Spirit and get this. But if you ever come to the place where you can just rest in that grace, I'm telling you, you'll wake up in the middle of the night and God will give you revelation.
Yes.
You can't believe it. Why? Because it's a gift from God. It isn't a part of your hard work and your laboring to understand. God just gives you wisdom by grace. Amen?
Amen.
To understand spiritual things. Able to know and understand the true nature of God. Think about this now. I'll just use myself as an example. Hey, I worked hard for Jesus. I mean, I wasn't the most successful, but I did work hard for Jesus. I mean, I went out and I handed out tracts and I gave up the TV and I, you know, shaved and wore the long sleeve. I did. I mean, I worked. And I taught Bible studies and I prayed and I fasted and I did all of that. And I didn't know God. I didn't really know the nature of God. I know the nature of God so much better today than I did 20 years ago. And I'm not doing anything except just listening.
Yes.
Just seeing Him the way He really is. Amen. That is a gift from God.
Yes.
How many of y'all struggled in religion? Just worked. I mean, worked and wanted to do right and wanted to be best and wanted to do everything that the Bible... And just so frustrated and... And now, I don't know about you, but I'm happy. I mean, I'm glad to know the Jesus I know today.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
And I can't take credit for it.
That's right.
There you go.
All I know is that years ago, when I resigned from the organization I was in, the Lord told me, unless you're willing to pick up this Bible and read it like it's the first time you've ever read it, you're not ever going any further than you are right now. And where I was right then was just frustrated, defeated, aggravated.
Sure.
And I can honestly say, I just tried to put out everything that I knew and just thought, hey, I'm rolling the dice. This is your business, God. I'm not trying to be rebellious or hateful or anything else. I just don't get it. I want a relationship. I don't want to just be a servant forever. I don't want to just be constantly worrying, looking over my shoulder if I did all of it right, crossed all the T's, dotted all the I's.
Amen.
And God, over the years, just, there are lots of places. I mean, you see it on TV. There are, I mean, you can turn on Christian television and you can get a spectrum of beliefs and teachings that will just screw you up big time for the rest of your life. If you believed all of it. I mean, if you just thought it must all be true. But somehow God gives us the ability to begin to discern between man's gospel and His gospel.
Nice.
And I can't take credit for it. I'm just glad. I'm just grateful. I mean, all of us are on the same journey. I mean, this is what God wants to do. He wants us to know Him. Not about Him. He wants us to know Him. Person to person. Not because of my relationship, you have a... somehow some voyeuristic kind of relationship. No, he wants you to know Him.
Yep.
The way He knows you.
Exactly.
Yep. Amen? Let's quit with this. John chapter 4, verse 8. John chapter 4. Or 1 John, I'm sorry, Mike. 1 John chapter 4, verse 8. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And I'll just wrap up with this. And His mercy towards us endures forever.
Amen.
Hallelujah. He's given you everything that pertains to life and to godliness. And He did it by grace.
Yes.
And it'll manifest as you begin to rest in it, as you begin to just think of the goodness of God, the love of God, and what He's provided for you. Amen?
Amen.
The devil's a liar.
Amen.
And God cannot lie.
Amen.
So who are you going to call? Praise the Lord. Amen. The Holy Ghost Buster. Praise the Lord. I'm calling on the Lord. Amen. Call on the Lord and trust that He's going to do exactly what He said He's going to do, not based on you, but based on His unfailing goodness and mercy. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Everybody say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
We love you, Jesus. Give Him a hand clap. Praise God. Amen. God bless you and go in the power of that Spirit. It's all you. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name, you're blessed. Amen.